Hey everyone, welcome back to The Fin Factor. I'm Freddie Mercury.
And I'm Aaron.
And this is episode number 25.
25.
Do you have a player number 25?
Barry Bonds.
Barry.
Who should be on everybody's Hall of Fame ballot.
This is a shark.
Haters.
You had one job.
Haters.
Anyway, so episode number 25, we're really happy that we got this far, and we're going to keep on trudging. So,
yep.
Today we're going to be talking about Martin Jones and the whole controversy with him and Aaron Dell and all that thing. We're going to maybe give a little bit of fuel for the haters, if you will. So
fun. Yeah. Eric Carlson is heating up.
Oh, yeah.
We'll talk about Pete DeBoer getting ejected last night.
That's fun.
Or, I guess, 2 nights ago if you're listening to this today.
And then we had it here. It's gone now. But we have a winner for the Google Home, which we may or may not start with. I don't know. We'll see. But we'll let you know who that is. And I think that is most of the episode. So,
yep.
You ready to start the show?
Ready.
Okay, good. Because I was like really, really worried because I saw the Vegas game and I am freaking out, man. So we are going to give the Google Home away. We'll do that right now. We'll let you know who won that. The Google Home has magically appeared on the set.
Ta-da!
And the winner, if we can do a little drum roll, Pete Smoot. Pete Smoot, wow, he had a very tiny chance to win and somehow pulled it off. I cannot believe it. Pete, one of the guys that was on the FanFest episode.
He was.
Yeah.
Go back. He was one of the guys answering the questions for us.
Which is really cool. So, yeah. Pete, congratulations on winning the Google Home.
Congrats. And now you can listen to us all the time.
we'll sign that for you and send it your way. We won't have to send it. I know where he works.
Oh,
well, just drive it over to him. Easy peasy. Anyway, so go ahead and get rid of this thing now. So we wanted to talk about, the first thing was Martin Jones and the stats and people comparing him with Aaron Dell and saying that Dell's the better goaltender. Why aren't we starting Dell? And we've kind of gone over this before as well. Dell is the backup. Martin Jones is the starter. There's no competition there. That's just the way it is. And so...
Well, there is competition.
Well,
but...
There's competition, but not to the point where Dell's going to oust Jones for the starting position, right?
Right?
And we've got some stats on that, which I'll go ahead and we'll put up on the screen right now. And so we've talked about it before with Dell... trying to take the starting position. And when Martin Jones went down last season, we could see here, in November, he had a 1.76 goals against average and a 9.38 save percentage. Then December, he got 2.06 goals against average and a 9.40 save percentage. And that's where we see in January when Jones went down, he had a 3.19 goals against average, so it ramped up. And the save percentage drops down to 8.96. And then even in February, same thing, it ramped up to 4.0 goals against average and 888 save percentage. So when he had to take on the starting role, it kind of fell apart for him, right? So that was the thing that people are saying right now is, you know, hey, we want to see Dell in the net more often. And it's like, well, we've seen this before already and Dell didn't really handle it. Yes, he's got great numbers, but being able to have that longevity, that's the difference between being a starter and a backup.
Right. And we've touched on this before about Martin Jones too, where Martin Jones, to me, I think he's a great goalie, but he's not an elite goalie. Aaron Dell, I don't even think he's at the level of Martin Jones right now. He's a great backup. He's great at throwing in there and give him a handful of games every month, and he's going to give you a very good chance to win where a lot of teams don't have that backup option.
Yeah.
Where that's a throwaway game, you know, hope you get some points, but with Dell, you almost kind of expect to get the points, which I can see where, you know, Jones, if he starts to struggle, people are going to call for Dell more.
Right.
And I think yesterday's game against Vegas is proof that kind of what we're talking about right now about Dell, like, he is a good option, but when you start stringing together multiple games like that, he's not quite at that level yet.
Yeah, and I think we'll touch on that game from yesterday a little bit more because I don't really put that one on Dell, but it is a good indication that it's not so much the goalie that you put in. It has more to do with the team defense and I think we'll talk about that a little bit later on.
Mm-hmm.
But there was a couple other stats that I wanted to bring up and I'll jump into those as well. They're put them up on the screen. And the thing that I wanted to call out really was that in wins, at least last season in wins, Jones ended up with a 1.7 goals against average and a 9.41 save percentage, which is ridiculous. But in those losses, he was a 3.53 goals against average with an 8.87 save percentage. Conversely, you look at Aaron Dell, and he had a 1.75 goals against average and a 9.45 save percentage in those wins that he played in. And in the losses that he played in, he had a 3.91 goals against average and an 8.64 save percentage. So in both cases, Dell being the, not worse really, but the lesser of the two. And the other interesting stat on here is that in losses, it says games played for Dell, 14. He started 8 of those games. So in 6 of those games,
relief,
he got brought in. So yes, he was in part of those losses, but really what it came down to was he was relieving Aaron, he was relieving Jones in those.
But he wouldn't get the loss if Jones has already given up those goals in his pull.
He doesn't get the loss, but he played in losses.
Right.
That's what that stat means.
Yeah. So it still pulls up
right
as a loss.
Yeah.
Oh, that kind of sucks for him. But
yeah. Well, it doesn't count as a loss against him, but it shows up as a game that they played in where they lost, and those were his stats. Mm. So, is what it is. There was only one other thing of stats that I really wanted to go into, and then we'll move on from this subject. And that is looking at the stats for Martin Jones and Aaron Dell over the past 3 seasons. And I say I chose 3 seasons because that's when Aaron Dell has really been getting a stride and playing games and whatnot. So, here's the graphic, and we can see that we've got, you know, Martin Jones and Aaron Dell showing them by season. And you can see the save percentages and the goals against average. For Jones, if you look at the save percentage in the 2016-2017, 912, and then on 2017-2018, it's 915. And then this season, it's down at 891. So yes, he is dropping off big time. And then looking at the goals against average, same thing, 2.4 in that first year, 2.55 in the second year, and then this season, he's up at 3.01. And, you know, yeah, so the case can obviously be made that, you know, Martin Jones has kind of fallen off a little bit this season by comparison to the other seasons, the previous two. Having said that, this season's not over yet, and this team largely has been playing poorly on the defensive side. So I think what you're going to see is the defense, not just the defense men, but team defense getting better as the season goes on, and both goaltenders having better stats as the season goes on. So I think that number is really going to jump up, and not the goals against average, hopefully not the goals against average, but save percentage jumping up, the goals against average really kind of dropping off a little bit. That's what I'm hoping to see.
Yeah, and typically we see in the NHL, the first 2 months, October, November, and maybe even a little bit into December, you're seeing referees call a lot more penalties, trying to establish themselves and establish what they want the game to look like. Then you start seeing the penalties dropping, the amount of power plays dropping per game. So you're going to see a lot more games getting tighter and closer and less power play chances. I think overall you're going to see scoring go down in the NHL, and I think the Sharks are going to also benefit from that in a way. They're going to tighten up defensively.
Yeah.
And we've seen in a few games, a handful of games this season, where they've been lights out on defense.
Yeah.
The penalty kill is amazing. The penalty kill is second in the league as of today.
Yeah.
So I don't think, you know, we talked about this earlier, when they're playing, they're focusing on defense and they're on the penalty kill, they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
So I don't think there's any problems there, and we've seen them be able to play defense.
Yeah, and I think that just kind of furthers the point, right? I think one of the reporters had asked after the 6-0 loss, and or maybe it was the 4-0 win. Either way, they're saying, you know, it doesn't really matter which goalie you put in; it's really how the team plays in front of them, right? And I think that's the way it is. I think in the 6-0 loss, that if you had Martin Jones in net, he wouldn't have necessarily made it any better or worse. The team in front of him just didn't play that great. And there was a specific play that Vlasic just seemed uninterested in the puck. I didn't physically see that because I wasn't there to watch that part of the game. But by all accounts that I've reading and listening on radio and whatnot, it just sounded like he just had a brain fart. And that's not something you're going to see Mark Edward Vlasic doing all the time. You're going to see him playing good, solid, stellar defense the majority of the time. And he just had an off night, along with everybody else in the Sharks, apparently, on that night. So
yeah, it was just a blowout to get him.
I think it was Jamie Baker who said, don't throw the tape away. Because a lot of times you have a sneaker like that, and you say, just throw the tape away, forget about it, don't worry about it. But it's good to take a look at the mistakes that were made and kind of go over them. I think you go over it just the one time, and then maybe you throw it away after that. But it's not a bad thing to really assess the problems that you're having. And again, it's a team defense problem. And I made this comment in the live show too. It's not the team's defense, but it's team defense. That's the 18 skaters that are on the ice in front of the goaltender, not just the 6 guys that are directly in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, yeah.
And speaking of those six guys that are directly in front of Martin Jones or Aaron Dell, EK65 heating up.
He is looking like the person that we
traded for,
hoped for, and traded for. He has 8 points in his last six games. Mm-hmm. He had 3 points against Vancouver.
Oh, yeah.
He had a goal and two assists. He got his first goal a couple games ago. Mm-hmm. So he's really heating up and looking good. And from Dan being on the show 2 weeks ago, Kurz being on last week, they both mentioned that scouts and everyone else were expecting 25, 30 games for him to get really acquainted.
Right.
And like Dan said, he's not just, you know, not just figuring out the hockey part. He has to figure out how to get to the rink every day, which is not easy in San Jose. I don't even know where he's living, which part of town he's living in. Mm-hmm. But him and his wife moved out here. And on that note, I should have brought this up with Dan. I think it's a good thing that his wife, who is from Ottawa, moved to San Jose.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's not like they kept their home in Ottawa and he's just playing here and then going back. So maybe that's a little tip towards him signing an 8-year deal. That could be another clue.
Yeah.
Who knows? I mean, just a thought.
Very well could be. Wishful thinking. I'm on board. I'm good with that. In fact, during the live that we had just before this, there was a question, you know, if you were to take, well, the question was two parts, right? It was, you've got two players and you have to pick, right? So you've got Burns and Carlson, and then you've got Timo and Hurdle. I said Hurdle not because there's anything wrong with Timo, but because I think Hurdle's been awesome in the faceoff circle and awesome with puck possession and everything else. And I think Hurdle's just an amazing player when he can stay healthy. Between Burns and Carlson, I said that I would rather take Carlson, and I know I'm going to get a lot of flack for that. And I think Burns is going to get more goals. I think Burns is probably going to get more points even. Yes, Carlson's great with the playmaking, and he'll probably have lots of assists, but he may get trumped by Burns. I mean, Burns, he's always out there tossing pucks over to Pavs. He's tipping them in, so he's probably going to pick up a lot of assists just from that alone. But with Carlson, I feel this very calming presence on defense when he's got the puck. He doesn't panic. He controls the puck really well, and he's so good with his stick and his skating that regardless of whether or not he's putting the puck on the net himself, he's generating that push to get up the ice. He's getting us through the neutral zone, you know? And I think that's the reason I would take Erik Karlsson over Burns if I were to just have one player or the other. Now, I'm not saying, I have to, again, reiterate this.
Right,
yeah. I am not saying that Burns is bad. That's not what I'm saying at all. If someone's forcing me to take one or the other and I have to give an answer, that would be my answer. So
I'm in the same boat. I think Karlsson, the difference between Karlsson and Burns is Karlsson makes the team and everyone around him better. And not necessarily that Burns makes everyone worse.
Yeah.
Burns is more of a finisher and creator of havoc. Mm-hmm. And he scores more goals. He has a wicked wrister.
Yeah.
And he just, the puck has eyes when he shoots the puck. So I see Burns as more of like a, like a scoring winger almost, playing defense, which is kind of what he is. And then Carlson is just that smooth, silky smooth skater that makes plays and makes everyone around him better because he's calm under pressure. Yeah. He gets one to two guys coming on him with pressure, and that leaves open another guy, and he will find him.
Yeah.
Almost like Joe Thornton, but way better skater.
I was going to relate it to that. I see Carlson as the defensive version of a Joe Thornton in his prime, we'll say, and I see Burns as the defensive version of, say, the Jonathan Chichi, right, where he's going to be the guy that's blasting the puck, that's finishing, that is really the threat that's out there, and you're worried about him getting the shot off. With Erik Karlsson, you're worried about what he's going to do around you, right, to pick you apart. And for those reasons, that's why I would pick Karlsson over Burns if I had to make the choice there. But
agreed.
That's kind of a fuel for haters. And on the same vein of that fuel for haters, we have some other things we wanted to talk about.
So the fuel for haters. Kurz had an article a couple days ago, I guess, kind of going over these stats a little bit. And I kind of updated a little bit going into today. Mm-hmm. So the Sharks, as of today, were leading the league in scoring and first period goals. They have 31 goals in the first period. In second period, they are the seventh worst team with only 20. In the third period, they are the 10th worst with 21. Mm-hmm. So they're scoring early. I think this is part of the reason why people are getting so upset and so panicky in a way is because...
Fanicky.
Hashtag fanic.
Yeah,
is sure. that what it was?
Let's do it.
Fresh catchphrase.
Yeah.
Fanic.
There you go.
I think what people see is the Sharks will take an early lead
yeah.
in the first period especially.
Right.
And give up that lead. So one of the stats that he had was in 14 games, they surrendered the lead. And that's not good.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, they're showing that they're an elite team by creating and scoring these goals, but they're not elite defensively, which kind of I feel like what we're used to in the past couple of years with yeah. the Sharks is we've seen them struggle to score the goals, but when they do, they hold the leads, the tight leads.
Yeah.
As we were alluding to earlier and what we're saying earlier, that's going to come this season. Pete DeBoer is very good at getting his team to do, as Kurz mentioned this last week. He gets their team, the Sharks, to really come together right at playoff time, mm-hmm. which is pretty much the most important thing, I think, for a team. You can be struggling early on, which they kind of are, but not really, because the Pacific is so weak.
Yeah.
So I think people are kind of overblowing this a little bit, and we're kind of going into our segment a couple of down. But
sure.
I think people are overblowing it a bit. That's about it.
Yeah, no, and I think that the interview, the post-game interview that DeBoer gave is saying exactly that, where he's saying, you know, he's looking at the reporters and he's saying, you know, I think you guys are making this into something that it's not, you know. Teams have bad games. Teams get blown out every once in a while. I think Calgary lost 7-1. Vegas lost 7-1 to Calgary is what it was. Right before the Sharks had played in Vegas. And sometimes this stuff happens, you know. Does it mean that we're always going to lose 6-0? To Vegas? No. Did we always beat Philadelphia 8-whatever? No. Right? I mean, there are times where teams get blown out, and there are times where you're just having a really bad game. You don't have your mojo going. You don't have the juice. Right? And this is just one of those games, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So on that topic with Pete DeBoer got ejected.
He did
from that game, which actually, you know what? In some ways, for me,
his first time. As a coach,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. In some ways, for me, that's a good thing. I related it to when we talk about this in the live. I relate it to when, you know, you're a player and you get slammed, right? And you don't see a freight train coming and it just hits you and you get up, you're dazed or whatever. The guy that's on the ice with you, maybe that Brendan Dillon, right, comes up and he starts grabbing the guy and say, you do that again, I'm going to knock your block off, right? That's kind of the equivalent of what Pete DeBoer did.
He grabbed the ref.
He went to the ref and said, yeah, exactly. No, so he goes to the ref and he didn't swear to him either, and which I think is hilarious. He's like I was saying, if you're gonna, you know, get ejected from a game, you may as well get your money's worth.
Yeah.
But he kept it clean, and at least before he got ejected, after he probably didn't keep it too clean. But you know, he told him, you know, did that feel good? You know, kicking Kane out of the game because Kane basically had a hip on hip hit, and they're down 5-0.
He was in the box for high stick.
Yeah,
he was upset because he didn't get a high stick called against him earlier in the game. Comes out of the box after the high stick, does this hip check, and gets called for a penalty. Then he started talking back to the ref.
Yeah.
Then he wasn't ejected for the hit. He was ejected for the
smack talk back.
Yeah.
But then DeBoer kind of says, did that feel good? Kicking him out of the game, whatever. And that's basically what he said, and he didn't even swear at him. And so he gets ejected. Well, I see that again as the equivalent of somebody on the ice stepping up and standing up for you after getting slammed, essentially, right? This is one of those things where I think the players are going to look back and say, you know, hey, Pete had our back here, right? And I think you're going to see an extra jump in their step against the Buffalo and against the Sabres,
right? Yeah.
And we'll talk about that too. But I feel like that's one of those things where, yes, he got ejected. Maybe he showed some emotion there, but I don't think that's a bad thing. I think that's a very good thing. And I think the players see that and appreciate it, to be honest.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Cool. I think it's similar to like a baseball manager getting tossed out of a game,
mm-hmm.
sticking up first player. It's kind of the same thing.
Yeah.
So the players will really appreciate that.
Yeah, good. And, you know, I just wanted to say one more thing actually about the goalies because we kind of jumped over. But there's their 5-on-5 play and their PK play. The PK, they're second best in the league, which is insane. I mean, it was 89-something percent or whatever was. Maybe not as of this recording, but second best in the league.
They're just behind Arizona.
There you go. And then their 5-on-5 play is not so hot, right? So I think that, again, points back to team defense as opposed to just – you know, it's this goalie or it's that goalie. I think when the team is focused on playing defensively, like you have to when you're on the PK, they are a very good team.
Yeah.
And I think when they're trying to pinch all the time, trying to go for more offense, and the wingers aren't necessarily cycling back to cover, that you start getting all these odd man breaks, and I think that's the root of the problems, and that's probably why you're seeing a lot of the 5-on-5 play be not nearly as good defensively in terms of the numbers as you see when they're focused on playing defense, even being a man down.
Yeah.
So anyway, jump ahead.
Going back to Coach.
Yes.
And everyone calling for DeBoer's head. Kurz talked about this last week as well, that it's pretty much ridiculous to fire Coach 24 games into the season right now.
Right.
Firing a coach where the team is not right. Well, we're behind Calgary right now in the division by a point.
Yeah.
Like, why would you get rid of your coach at that point? It's just silly to me. So, looking at the other, you know, there's been multiple firings now in the league. So,
yeah.
Edmonton, St. Louis, LA, and Chicago all got rid of their coaches. Yeah. Edmonton just replaced Todd McClellan, former Sharks head coach, with Ken Hitchcock, who came out of retirement. Ken Hitchcock is, I think, I don't like his coaching style because it's so boring. He is like
shutdown
defense. Like just everyone block shots. Yeah. Everybody play defense. It's very boring. It works for teams who are awful at defense, like the Edmonton Oilers. So you're gonna see Edmonton's games get a lot tighter now.
Yeah.
You're gonna be hard to find blowout wins, I think, in Edmonton. That's going to make the Pacific a little bit better. I don't know much about the Kings coach. And Coach Q is the bigger factor here, getting let go in Chicago. So a lot of people want him to come to the Sharks. Now, we talked about this in the live segment, I think, very early on. I don't think I think there's zero chance of him coming to San Jose for one. I don't think they're going to fire DeBoer. If they do, I think it's a really nearsighted thing to do.
Yeah.
Hiring Coach Q, this guy is getting paid $6 million a year through this season and into next season. If anyone signs him, he doesn't get that $6 million. Why would anybody give that up? That means San Jose would have to offer more than $6 million for a coach.
Yeah.
Right? So I don't see it happening. So calm down on that. I don't even think Coach Q is going to be on a team this season. Maybe in the summertime. Someone's going to get desperate enough to
maybe
hire him.
I think if you can sit back and make $12 million for taking a vacation, I'd probably take the vacation, to be honest with you. I mean, and you'd be brought up the point, too. Like, if it was your wife, she would say, no, you're staying home.
Yeah.
Right?
So, yeah. If my wife would be like, no, you're definitely not going to work. Because
he's been coaching for a long time.
Exactly.
He deserves
been doing
a break.
It for a long time.
Right?
Yes. One of the winningest coaches, I think, too.
Yeah.
Him and Hitchcock, both.
Mm-hmm.
So DeBoer's just fine. calm down. That was my point.
Nice. So let's see. What else are we going to talk about? Stay calm.
Right.
Yeah, we want to stay calm.
Let's stay calm.
And I think that's perfect segue from the let's not fire Pete DeBoer and go straight into let's just stay calm, please. Okay. So
yes.
The Vegas game obviously causing a lot of turmoil. The thing we have to remember is on this show, we're trying to look at more of a macro view, right? And that's why I brought up stats from Martin Jones for the past like 3 years. Yes, this season he's not doing very well, but the season isn't done yet. And so we want to see what's his body of work like? Where is he trending? Which way would he be trending right now? He's kind of trending down, but the season's not over. Team defense can tighten up and his stats can go up, right? So we just have to remember that the Vegas game where we lost 6-0, that's just a single point in time. And again, we're not going to lose to Vegas every time 6-0. We're not going to beat Philadelphia every time 2, I think it was.
8-2.
Yeah. These are single points in time where one team was really feeling it and the other team really wasn't, and they happen to come together on the same time. Really not something that we need to panic about. So yes, on that front, I would say stay calm. Yeah.
Right, and I went back and looked at Washington Capitals' season last year, see how many blowout losses they had. They had one early in I guess it was late October. They lost 8-2.
Mm-hmm.
They lost a couple other ones 6-1, like 7-4.
And some of those games were in February.
Right, and here's a team that went on to win the Cup.
Right.
So I think the 6-0. Even Pete even said like we just came off of a 3-game
4-1-1.
Right.
Yeah,
and we're just fine. We had one bad game where you lost Kane, and someone else got kicked from that game too. Other than DeBoer,
Goodrow.
Was it Goodrow?
I think Goodrow
got kicked out too. So I mean, your bench is getting shorter. Your bench boss isn't even there. So I think it's fine, and I almost am glad that Aaron Dell was in goal for that game, because if that was Martin Jones, people would be grabbing their pitchforks.
Calling for his head.
Yeah, like just, they would be insane online.
Yeah.
So that brought Arundel down to earth. I think it brought down the haters on, you know, Jones not being the starter anymore.
And again, I think it should bring to light that it's not one guy it's going to make the difference.
Exactly.
It's not the one guy that's in net that's going to make that difference. It's the team playing as a unit or not. If you're not playing it as a unit, I don't care who you have in net, it's not going to go over well. Something else I brought up on the live, you guys should really check out the lives because you're getting a lot of really good information from that. You know, I've seen AHL goaltenders not play so hot in the AHL. They come to the NHL and all of a sudden playing pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of it has to do with the AHL defensemen suck. Like, is really what it comes down to. You know, you've got these young promising forwards that they're playing against, but the defensemen that are there, you know, defensemen are in short supply anyway, and you start playing at the AHL level, they're not really that hot.
Yeah, if you're good, you're going to be on the NHL team.
Probably, yeah. So, you know, you've got these really good forwards who are going up against a not-so-hot defenseman. Well, now you make it to the NHL. As a goaltender, I'd rather play in the NHL than the AHL because you're going to have a much better group in front of you. Well, didn't happen in Vegas, obviously,
right.
But generally speaking, you want to play, your stats are going to be better when you have better team in front of you than if you had a worse team in front of you.
And a perfect example is Antti Niemi winning a cup in Chicago.
There you go.
Their team defense is amazing, or was back then.
Yeah.
Was amazing. And it seemed like he would make the first save, maybe even the second save, and then they clear out the rebounds, and there was no second or third chances for most teams. So they went on to win a cup that way, building around their defensive strength of their team. And I know that's just going to fuel fire for bringing Coach Q in, but I think DeBoer always gets them playing very well going into the playoffs, and I'm not worried.
Yeah.
In fact, going back two seasons ago when we went to the cup finals, the Sharks were out of a playoff spot in January, and I think Kerr said it was 16-16 and whatever, four went ties or something.
Mm-hmm.
Tie
points. 18-18 and two or something.
18-18. Yeah. They were 500 basically and out of a playoff spot.
Yeah.
And then got hot and went into the playoffs hot. I'd rather it be that way than be the Sharks of whatever 10 years ago when they won the President's Trophy and bow out in the first round.
Yeah.
I don't. The regular season to me is just not as important as playoffs or even the end of the regular season going into the playoffs. So I'm very comfortable where they are. I'm more comfortable in the fact that the Pacific Division is garbage this year. So they are more than welcome to backpedal their way into a playoff spot. I'm fine with it. I'm fine with it because I think they're going to do their damage in the playoffs.
Yeah.
No, even against Vegas, they're gonna, if they get pitted up against, this is what people are afraid of, is the way that the playoff format is, you're playing your divisional opponent now. Playing Vegas or even Calgary in a 7-game series, I still think the Sharks are stronger.
Well, and the thing to remember too is in the regular season, yes, you're preparing for a team. In the playoffs, you're not just preparing for a team for a night. You're preparing for a long stretch of games, and you're really analyzing every little tiny thing that that team does.
Mm-hmm.
And the matchups that you put on the ice mean a whole heck of a lot more, right?
Yeah.
So it means a lot more in the playoffs to dissect everything from the coaching standpoint, not from the fan standpoint. From the coaching standpoint, they're going to dissect it much more tightly and much more finely than they would if it was the regular season.
What are we going to do during playoff
time? I have no clue. Actually, I mean, I would love to do... we talked about...
We might be doing more live segments during the playoffs.
Yeah, we talked about maybe doing some more, because we really enjoy doing the live shows, so I think we might have to pick up on during the playoffs doing
it's
some lives.
It's just like each game.
Yeah.
We can't do a week,
right?
Once a week thing during playoffs. Our producer's going to be very happy with us.
Oh, yeah, totally. That. Yeah, it's going to be fun.
We just thought about that right now. We haven't even talked about it yet.
In any case, we don't want to look too far ahead, so let's look maybe a little bit shorter ahead. The next few games coming up here, we've got some pretty big ones.
Right. We got first in Buffalo,
then
in Toronto back-to-back,
mm-hmm.
and then a couple days later, they are going to be in Ottawa.
Which is insane. You think about it. We have a back-to-back, and then we get 2 days where we're still traveling, and then we have another back-to-back. I think we have a third back-to-back, don't we?
No, you're talking about the week.
After that, there's another one.
Yeah.
Which is just nuts.
It's the life of a West Coast NHL team.
There you go.
Most West Coast teams are like that.
So the first one is Buffalo. Now, personally, and I'll let you talk on this too, I'm looking for a big, big bounce back game. Not because they got smacked around and I just want them to come back, and you know, not because of that. I think that, again, DeBoer getting kicked out of that game for having stuck up for Kane, I feel like they're going to feel like, hey, DeBoer's got our back. We're going to put up for this guy, right? I feel like there's a level of camaraderie that, again, being tossed out of that game may have stirred up for that team with the coach, right? So there's been some speculation that maybe DeBoer doesn't have the locker room, right? The locker room's out of... unless you are in that locker room, that's all speculation. Let's not go there. But I will say that I feel like, because I don't know, obviously, I feel like him getting kicked out for sticking up for Kane is going to bring them closer together, not just the players, but the whole coaching staff and everything as a unit. And those guys are going to push hard come Tuesday against Buffalo.
Yeah. I think, well, for Buffalo, it's going to be homecoming for Evander Kane.
Oh, yeah.
So I think he plays very well with a lot of hate on him. So I'm wondering if they're going to be booing or cheering him there. And not that he was a villain or anything while he was there, but on his way out of there and out of Winnipeg, it seemed to be not on great terms.
Yeah.
Not the best of terms. Not that it was terrible, but not the best. So I'm wondering, I bet he's going to elevate his game. We're going to see a big game from Kane.
Yeah.
And then I think we do see a bounce back. I mean, this is what I'm hoping for. A big bounce back game, obviously. Buffalo is one of the hottest teams in the NHL right now. They are a very young team and just starting to gel and get everything together. And they've had their problems over the past couple seasons, just never making playoffs. Mm-hmm. So they are red hot right now. And then back-to-back going from there to Toronto, I think the Sharks, I think the Sharks are going to beat Buffalo, which they have a hard time playing in Buffalo. They're going to beat Toronto because they play well against the coach in Toronto. I keep blanking on his name.
Babcock.
Yeah. Babcock's teams, when he was on Detroit, like that was like just a big...
Automatic?
Not automatic, but... to me, this team, this Sharks team, plays up to their opponent.
Okay.
Or down to their opponent.
Okay.
Depending on who they are. So, playing on the big stage against Toronto, Toronto beat them at home, and it's kind of embarrassing. I think the Sharks are going to go into Toronto. A lot of the Sharks players are from Toronto. They're going to have a lot of family and friends there. They tend to play up for those games. So, I think most of those players are going to be, just like in Nashville, a very hard place to... I mean, at that point in Nashville, they only had one or two losses, and... They were down two goals going into the third period, and they scored three to take the win.
See, and I think the hard thing here is it's a back-to-back, right? We just had a back-to-back. Dell started. So we play Martin Jones against Buffalo, I think. I don't think you start Dell a third game in a row, especially after getting a 6-0 loss in your hands. Yeah. I think it was admirable, in my opinion, that Dell stayed in net because he could have said, just get me out of here, right? But
I'm actually shocked they didn't put Martin in.
Well, I think the reason is you're going to start Martin Jones, right?
Yeah.
So don't give him any, you know, playing time. Let Dell take his lumps so that Martin Jones can come in fresh. I think that's a good call. So you're going to have, I think you're going to play Martin Jones against Buffalo. And then you got to go Toronto? Right back to Dell in Toronto.
I think what they should do is Martin
back-to-back.
Jones,
yeah.
Depending on how they do in Buffalo and how much rubber he sees.
Yeah.
If it goes to overtime or a shootout, maybe they don't. But if it's a 20 shots, 20 saves, and he gets a really good win, throw him in there again in Toronto. I think it would go Jones.
You know, the other way to think of that, too, is if he gets shelled and he doesn't do well, DeBoer might throw him back in and say, get your win. You know what I'm saying? Like, stank. You stank in this game. If he does happen to lose,
If he gets pulled from Buffalo, they'll pull him early so that he's fresh for the next day.
Yeah, for sure. But that might be one of those games where it's like, okay, if you know, you got to prove it now. Get in there. I don't care that it's the next game. It's a back-to-back. Get in there and do it, right? So who knows? We'll see. But I think that's the dilemma for that stretch of games, those first two, is that it's a back-to-backer. Right?
And that was another question we had on the live segment. It was a good question. Like, what would you do? Who would you put in there? So for me, I would say Jones.
I absolutely start Jones, and then I see where it goes from there. And yeah, either Jones again, or yeah, back to Dell. Now,
then we have the Ottawa game a couple of days later, and this is going to be a homecoming for Carlson. We're probably going to see, I don't know if they'll show it on TV, but they'll probably at the game have a video tribute to Carlson, thanking him. Be very emotional. It's going to be a very emotional time for Carlson. Mm-hmm. I think we see a big game from him, obviously. And I think we also see a big game from the Sharks because they're going to want to be there for him and be like, we're your new home, we're your new family. Mm-hmm. So I think three big games this week. It's going to be a great week for Sharks
which
games.
Is interesting because, you know, we were saying Ottawa was a dumpster fire earlier in our episodes, and now it's we're talking about Ottawa being a big game, you know, but for other reasons, obviously. Now, in the Ottawa game, I don't know who you would I would aim to start Jones.
I would start Dell in that game.
Oh, okay, really?
If they did Jones, and I put Dell in.
Okay. Well, yeah, sure, right. But, see, I don't know. If you want your best chance to get that win for Eric.
Whatever, man. I think you need to rest because the next week there's back-to-backs again.
It was a trick question for you. You almost didn't bite for it. It doesn't really matter who you put in goal.
Right.
What matters is how the team plays in front of that goalie. So,
well, I think it does matter in terms of giving confidence to Jones to being playing.
Sure.
If he plays well.
I'm saying in terms of getting the W. If you don't have good team defense in front of your goalie,
right.
It could be you in net. Not going to matter.
Right. That would definitely matter if I were in the net.
Well, you played soccer.
Right, so the same thing.
It's a smaller net. You should be fine.
It's a smaller puck compared to a ball.
In any case, yeah, so I think that was all we're going to talk about with the looking ahead stuff, right?
Yeah.
There are other games, but we'll get to that in another episode. So, I think that was it. We already gave away the Google Home.
Yeah,
was there anything else? Oh, last thing I wanted to talk about here was, two things, actually. One, the lip chinchilla that I've got going on here, we're going to say goodbye to that very soon. So if you are not subscribed, please subscribe because you'll get a notification when we go live before the next episode.
Next week, we will be shaving
it live.
Yeah.
Just because why not?
It'll be fun. But also please donate towards the cause.
Yes.
We're not getting the money, so we're not asking money for us. It goes towards cancer research. Correct?
Well, it goes to just men's health issues. So
okay.
Testicular cancer, prostate cancer, suicide prevention, things like that. So it's kind of a wide range, right? And so that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to raise some awareness for it. And I've had this disgusting thing on my upper lip for a month, and my wife hates it. And she cannot wait for December 1st. I told her she has to wait till December 2nd because that's the next show.
Yeah.
But yeah, so if you can please give it, find it in yourself to give some sort of donation for men's health issues and whatnot. The ending of Movember, we're right at the end here. So mobro.co/thefinfactor, we're going to put it right down there.
We'll also put it in the description down below.
Yeah, because
so
if you click
on it,
you'll pause the video. Yeah. Anyway, so we would appreciate it. Again, the money doesn't go to us. It goes to a good cause, which wouldn't be us. So in any case, the other thing I wanted to show you was this sweet backpack behind me, if you didn't catch it. I went to the game and got a backpack or two or four. So I love them. They're really awesome. They've got like three, four different like pouches and there's straps all over the place.
It's actually a legit backpack.
It is.
That's not like a $2 giveaway.
That's no.
Like, it's like $10 giveaway.
It's really nice.
It's impressive.
Yeah, it's a pretty nice little backpack. So if you guys are really good, I might be giving one of these away because, like I said, I got four. So
I want one.
We'll see. Well, okay, I have three. So in any case, yeah, be looking out for that one. No promises, but maybe. So, but if you are subscribed, then you will get all the notifications, and you will see if I am giving one of those away. So always a good idea,
right?
Hit the subscribe button. Hit the bell. Leave a comment too. We really love talking with you guys, and anytime we see a comment, we're generally responding to it. The live stuff we love doing. We're looking forward to doing some more of that content as well. So, with that said, that is the end of episode number 25. Thank you so much for tuning
in. Thank you.
Anything else you want to throw out there?
That's all.
Good
I got.
To go. Okay. Yeah. Then we will see you guys
next week.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Hey everyone, thanks for checking out the show. You can support us by following us at The Fin Factor on Twitter and Facebook. You can also find us on Instagram as @FinFactor.
If you're listening to us as a podcast, please, please, please give us a 5-star review. And if you want to support our show, share our episode with your friends. Please leave us a comment of what you thought of this episode. And if you want us to cover anything else, let us know.